Hey, what's up everyone? Tom here. This is not MKBHD, but I thought a format like this would work for reporting on a few really interesting things that I found at Formnext. I've just been to way too many shows recently, so I'll keep this one brief, and I'll just have this one video with what I got to see in the 23 hours I spent in Frankfurt. And the first thing is this true 6-axis 3D printer. You've probably heard of 2.5D versus 3D printing, where there was a new slicer that would follow the top contour of your models, but this is a whole new story. So what the folks at 3D are doing is they're using a full 6-axis robot arm, and that angles and moves the printhead so that it will actually never print an overhang. They're both taking into account how each area of your part would ideally be printed, and also what your printer or robot arm can actually do motion-wise, and tries to create an ideal toolpath from that. Now, of course, we've seen similar approaches before with research projects and papers on this very topic, but it looks like 3D are the first ones who are actually going to have something they'll be able to release, and that hopefully we will be able to use one day. They're just a two-man team right now, or so, and one of the core challenges they found was that it's incredibly tricky to adapt this approach to different motion platforms. If you think about it, a classic XYZ 3D printer never has to worry about whether it's, you know, crashing into one of the printed parts, but with a setup that itself moves around the part, that becomes an exercise in crash avoidance and using the motion range of your robot. I think you can see why they chose to use these Tetris pieces to demonstrate the approach, but they're working on making this work for more complex shapes too. Either way, they want this setup to be as automated as possible. You know, just like you don't tell your slicer right now that, you know, this bit is a bridge and that bit is a perimeter and so on. Instead, it's one profile that makes some more or less intelligent decisions on how to print separate areas. That's exactly what they want to achieve with a 6-axis setup too. This part right here was actually just printed with what CNC machines would call 3+2-axis, where you orient your part in a specific direction with the machine, lock the position down, and then, you know, you treat the rest of the job as a 2.5-axis operation. But what 3D is actually going to be is, you know, what it called simultaneous 5-axis machining, or 6-axis in their case. They're not quite sure yet what exactly their product is going to be, whether it's going to be a licensed software library, or whether they'll be working with machine manufacturers as consultants to help them build machines that use that approach. They definitely don't want to become machine manufacturers themselves. But since this is a big topic and one that you can really nerd out about, I of course suggested that they at least open source their core library so that this entire community can make use of and work on and help improve the software, which would be really awesome. If they do, I'm sure we're going to see tons of 3D printed robot arms printing 5-axis parts. So next up, a quick update on the Oneclick Metal affordable laser powder bed fusion machine. Of course, affordable means something else for everyone. But their machine is a 3D printer that builds solid metal parts that need no post-processing to get their full strength. Unlike something like the BSF UltraFuse filament that still needs debindering and then sintering steps to even turn into somewhat solid metal, the prints from the Oneclick Metal machine at most need some machining for functional surfaces, and you know, they're basically as strong as a cast or a machined part. Formnext was the big reveal for them, and they finally announced the retail prices of their machines. The MPrint printer itself is 45,900 euros, and the MPure cleaning and powder sieving station is 21,900 euros if you want that too. Of course, that is more expensive than an Ender-3, but in the world of direct metal printing, that's a pretty dope deal. The last time I had seen the final machine, it was still just a blank stainless steel box, and the prototypes were, well, prototypes, but this now is the real deal, and it does look pretty. Also, if you didn't know, it runs a version of Octoprint. As far as I know, Gina is even involved in this, so again, thumbs up for using and supporting open source the proper way. They also showed the final cartridge design that you can use to supply powder to the machine, but the same cartridges will also be used to collect the overflow from printing. They'll serve as containers for moving powder to and from the sieving and cleaning unit. I mean, it feels really well thought out. Okay, and the last thing I took a look at is the BCN3D Epsilon. It's hard to say that, you know, you always want to say BCN Sigma, but this is the Epsilon. There's been a bit of a controversy about what exactly that enclosure is they've got around this machine. Is it actively heated? Is it passively heated? Is it actively temperature controlled? I mean, a big printer that is supposed to handle higher temp materials better have some sort of temperature controlled enclosure, but every extra degree helps when you're trying to print a massive PETG or nylon part. So what BCN3D are using here is just the heated bed that heats up the enclosure, the inside of the enclosure. There's no separate heater element or anything, but there is a fan in the back that will kick in when the interior gets too hot. As they've explained, it looks like the bed heats up the enclosure to about the right temperature without any input anyways. For example, with a bed at ABS temperatures around 120 degrees, the enclosure gets to about 60 degrees or so. That's kind of hot for electronics and motors, so they've moved the motor drivers and extruders out the back, but they're keeping the spools inside the enclosure to keep the material heated and dry. You know, that's a pretty smart move. Of course, with lower temperature materials like PLA, the enclosure itself also will not heat up as much. Though on the other hand, with PLA, you kind of want cooler temperatures, so we'll see how that works out. For the fan, they've got a HEPA and activated carbon filter. The hot ends are the same E3D made ones as in the Sigma series. It's got Wi-Fi, you've got a 420 by 300 by 400 millimeter build area, which is a lot bigger than the Ultimaker S5, by the way. But the Epsilon is also a bit more expensive than the S5. In either case, it's always good to have options, and BCN3D have actually finally managed to become, I guess, what do you call a proper company, because so far the team that developed the Sigma was really just a handful of people. So yeah, Formnext was fun. It was awesome meeting some of you in person and seeing the mix of industrial, consumer, and open source developments right next to each other. And it looks like Formnext is actually trying to keep the show a mixed event, which I do like. But for just being there, not even a day, it was just way too big of an event. There were four halls filled to the brim, and I probably only even walked through half of it all. So I hope you enjoyed that quick look at a few things from the event. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next one.